thank you for inviting me to speak. Today I'm going to be talking to you a little bit about supplier auditing, so supply chain auditing, building on a lot of the themes that everyone's talked about today, but just in a little focus of being externally facing. Just a little bit about me. This is a photo taken about 20 years ago and I refuse to replace it. My name is Kate Krachai. I've been in the industry for about 20 years or so now. I'm a biomedical scientist by training. Started out working in pharmaceutical R&D development, production, but very quickly saw the dark side of quality and edged myself in that direction. So I am a practicing QA manager, I'm a practicing qualified person. So in the pharmaceutical industry, that's somebody who takes the legal and compliance responsibility to release products to market or to clinical studies. I'm a practicing responsible person, so that same kind of responsibility in a wholesale supply chain as well. Qualified pharmaceutical lead auditor, so on a, if not a daily basis, but certainly weekly basis, I am routinely planning, managing supplier audits, delivering supplier audits for a really wide variety of organisations within the pharmaceutical and healthcare sector, but really across the board, some startups, some smaller organisations, right through to kind of global players as well. So supplier auditing and quality is something that I am incredibly passionate about. There are lots and lots of different right ways of doing things. I think that's one of the joys of being an auditor. You see so many different ways of doing great things. And I think looking outside of your own organisation and looking at how others implement quality standards, how they deliver compliance within their organisations, is a really lovely way to get an oversight of that and to bring some of those learnings back to your own organisations as well. We've touched upon this in some of the earlier presentations, but there are lots of reasons why you might want to audit your suppliers. But I've just summarised a few of them here, really. You might need to work with new suppliers. I think, again, global supply chains, cost cutting, innovations, developments. There are lots of reasons why we might need to bring new suppliers on board into our portfolio. And one of the ways of helping to select them, certainly not the only way, but a really good way of forming a good picture of that organisation and whether they are somebody you want to work with, whether they're going to be able to meet the needs of your own organisation, is by auditing them as part of a vendor selection programme. Obviously, if you're working with organisations, you have been working with them for a while, that periodic review of their performance is another reason why you might want to go back and visit them and perform a supplier audit. So there are different ways of doing that, obviously, visiting them on site versus a paper-based approach versus a remote audit. But from time to time, after that initial site visit, that initial kind of analysis and evaluation of whether you did want to work with them, you started working with them, at some point you are going to want to go back and revisit and perform another audit of that organisation. And then unfortunately, there is the bottom scenario here where, you know, things don't always go right. Be prepared for failure. Things don't always go right. Sometimes we do have those, oh my goodness, moments as organisations where we do get kind of catastrophic failures. We have problems with supply quality. We may then need to, as quality professionals, as auditors, go into those organisations and understand what on earth happened there. What did they not tell us? What's going on there? What could we go and see and help them kind of troubleshoot? But three main reasons why you might want to be visiting your suppliers to conduct a supplier audit. And I, like I said before, I absolutely am passionate about supplier auditing. I think there are loads and loads of benefits that can come out of visiting your suppliers and conducting those audits. If we went around the room, I think we could probably come up with 70 different benefits of auditing an organisation. I've distilled this down to a handful here. So ultimately, the reason we're going to visit our suppliers is to verify the standards that they're operating to. So they might send us a lovely pack of documentation, they might have a lovely certificate on their website, they might have some beautiful corporate literature, but are they actually complying to the standards that they tell us that they are going to? It's not always the case. So let's go and see it with our own eyes. Let's see how they are operating. Let's see if they can walk the walk as well as talk the talk, and gather some, hopefully, positive evidence to support what they've already told us. As part of that, obviously, as well, is ensuring that they do have functional quality systems in place. So are they managing changes internally? Are they dealing with their non-conformances appropriately? Do they have a strong quality culture? Are the management committed to quality at that organisation? Is that quality system functional, and is that important to them? Theme of today, really, identify risks. So that could be risks to compliance. It could be risks to future delivery of service. It could be financial risk. It could be a myriad of things. But as you say, being there, walking the walk, and seeing things with your own eyes, you will spot things, you will hear things, you will identify things that perhaps not going to the site, not visiting them, not conducting that audit, you wouldn't have necessarily been aware of. It's also a really, really fabulous opportunity to develop a dialogue with your suppliers. So we've heard people talk already today about internal auditors and building those relationships, important communications. The same is the case for yourself and your suppliers, or for folks who audit you as a supplier of their business. So there is no better way than building relationships face to face, having that dialogue, building up a rapport and an empathy with people. And hopefully that will really help you to strengthen those long-term business relationships that you hope to have. You can tell a lot about an organisation in the way that they receive you, the way they host you, how seriously they take that audit. And again, the same goes for you on the other side of the fence. If you're responsible for hosting audits of your own organisation, the way that you receive somebody, host them, make them feel welcome, present documentation, have that open and honest attitude, it goes an awful long way. And very much, from my perspective and my experience, forms part of the vendor assessment. So yes, we're very fine standards. Yes, we want to know that the quality system is in place, but ultimately, can we get along with these guys? Do we want to work with them? Are they nice people? Do I want to pick up the phone and have a conversation with this other quality manager when something goes wrong? Or is actually that going to be one of the most difficult conversations in my life? In which case, if I've got another vendor over here who's much nicer to work with and much easier to work with, operating to the same standards, it's going to influence my decision making. So that face-to-face rapport building and the communications is a really strong benefit of conducting supplier audits. We can obviously also, as we audit more and more suppliers, we document them in the way that we've talked about today, we're comparing those kind of scorecards, we can evaluate suppliers a little bit more side by side. We can conduct vendor selection audits to evaluate a handful of suppliers and look at them side by side to see if one is better than. I say better, every company's criteria will be different. For some it will be quality and price, it will be responsiveness, it will be how they deal with you, whatever criteria is important to your business. But performing audits of your suppliers gives you that data to compare them side by side. And I genuinely do believe that conducting supplier audits helps you to reduce costs to the business, quality costs of non-conformance, of product recalls, of those unanticipated issues. The more information you gain, the more knowledge you gain of a site, the more you can anticipate things, you can help troubleshoot. The more you develop that rapport, the more likely that supplier is to pick up the phone to you and go, Dave, I'm just letting you know, it's not written down in a non-conformance yet, but we've just had this massive issue on such and such a line, or I think we're going to be really squeezed for delivery of that product at the end of the month, I'm just letting you know. That can really help your organisation to look around corners, and supplier auditing can help you to do that. And with the growth of our global economies, global supply chains, numerous partners, it's our job as auditors, as quality professionals, not just to ensure the quality or oversee the quality of our supplier who kind of, you know, lives down the road and delivers us our product every day on the back of their van driven by the son of the organiser. We need to ensure quality throughout the supply chain. So the quality of our product is only equivalent to the quality oversight that we apply through that entire supply chain. And supplier auditing can obviously help us do that. So a bit of a busy slide here, and I don't purport to know this supply chain or whether it exists or not. But really just an illustration to say, you know, long gone are the days where all our suppliers were down the road or even in the same country or spoke the same language or operated to the same quality standards. We use brokers more than ever before. We use middlemen. We transport our product from A to B to C to back to D to over here and back around the houses again. We pack it in one place, we sterilise it in another place, we over-label it in another place, we warehouse it somewhere else, it's split over here. We have the lovely online world to deal with now. We have data that's stored in the cloud and it's not in paper, and we're not necessarily dealing with people all the time. So looking at our supply chains and forming an approach to supplier quality management is not easy. If this were our supply chain and we've got our little auditing group, how are we going to perform audits of all of those vendors? Well, we're not. Are they all equal? Well, they're not. And so what we need to do now in the kind of the world and the supply chains that we live in, but also because it makes absolute business sense and quality sense, is take this risk-based approach. So numerous industries have been adopting this for quite a few years. Other industries are slower to pick it up. I am an absolute convert, firm believer in the risk-based approach to auditing, risk-based approach to anything. There's a whole new conference on that, isn't there? A risk-based approach to absolutely everything else to do with quality, but it's absolutely true. We've only got finite resources. We've only got finite time. So applying the same principles to absolutely every single system, process, supplier is just not going to be the best use of our time. What we need to do is think about where the risks are in our supply chain, in our operations, in our products, in our organisations, and think about developing some criteria, some questions that we can ask ourselves to look at. Well, I'm going to try and go back now. That's my win for today. So to look at all of those players in that supply chain and go, so where are the risks? So this warehouse in the middle here, do you know what? We've been working with them for 20 years. They send us KPIs every month. They hit the targets we're going to send them every month. We've audited them every 2 years for the last however long. Are they high risk? Are they low risk? Do we really need to audit them every year for the rest of eternity? When we've got a brand new courier down here who we've audited once as part of our vendor selection process, the complaints that we get are going through the roof. They never respond when we want to speak to them. And we're throwing away half of our product because they can't be bothered to handle it appropriately. It's a higher risk. I'm being very flippant with the categories that I'm talking about, but not all players in that supply chain are equal. And so what we need to do as organisations when we are thinking about our vendor audit plans is to come up with those risk categories and think about what the risks are to us, to our organisation, to our products, to our customers. And then audit more frequently, apply more resource in the areas of higher risk, and with gathering data, and keep on gathering data to support our kind of categorisation of low risk for some of those vendors, and apply our resource in those areas of high risk. So it will help us be cost effective in terms of applying our resource in the most risky areas. But it should also help us be cost effective in terms of the delivery of our product, of our service, whatever that is, because if we are focusing our audit resource in those areas of higher risk, we are hopefully helping to address findings, to reduce non-conformances, to improve the quality of those organisations. So that has a knock-on effect, because then we're dealing with less complaints, with less changes, with less firefighting. We're improving the systems of those vendors, as well as our own oversight systems, through that risk-based approach to auditing. And so we should not only enhance the quality of our own organisation and our own product, but the quality of the operations at the sites that we are visiting more frequently. So again, I don't pretend that this is an exhaustive approach, but I knew that if I didn't put anything up here, somebody would ask me, what are the kind of things that you can put in a risk-based approach, risk-based assessment? So I've thrown some up here. I'll go through them, but genuinely, they are unique to every single organisation and to the products that you supply, the services you supply, the networks that you have, your reach, the regulations that you work with. But here are just a kind of couple of factors that you could think about. So the complexity of the product, is it a really nightmare product to make? Are there a lot of steps along the way? Are there lots of things that could go wrong? Or is it relatively simple, more higher risk versus low risk? Controversially, I put location of vendor here. We should work to global standards across many industries, but certainly in my industry, in the pharmaceutical industry, there are GXP standards and there are GXP standards. So certainly from my perspective, if a vendor is in Europe or is in the North America, Japan, for example, countries that we've got kind of mutual recognition agreements with, I'm less concerned than other countries outside those areas. So the weighting that you put on these different risk factors might be very different, but there is definitely, in my industry, a higher risk for going outside Europe for your supply than there is from remaining within Europe. As we were saying earlier, in terms of gathering that kind of ongoing data, how many complaints do you get related to that service? How many complaints have you made against that supplier? How many non-conformances do you typically have? Have you ever had any product recalls with that supplier? So again, it's if you've got like-for-like suppliers and some of them are performing where they're delivering you loads of non-conformances, loads of complaints, loads of recalls, versus others where everything's ticking over beautifully, you can consider that as a higher risk. How many of you have KPIs in place for your suppliers so that you are getting information from them on a periodic basis of how they are performing? Oh yeah, cool. For me, it's brilliant. You have to trust them. You've got to know that they're measuring them correctly and that they are giving you the right data, but a periodic input, it's kind of an ongoing check inspection like we were saying before. So you aren't physically going and auditing them. You're not even asking for it every month, hopefully, through the agreements that you've got in place with them. It's just a mechanism. They're happy to send those to you. You know, how many reworks do they have? How much line stoppage do they have? How many on-time deliveries or delayed deliveries do they have? It's a good way for you to assess their performance and, again, rate suppliers side by side. So if they're performing really well with the KPIs that you're using to monitor them, then are you really concerned to go back and audit them as frequently as somebody else who never hits their KPIs or doesn't even send you them when you ask for them? And a big factor again is, are they your only vendor for that particular product or service? So think about the what if scenario of if something went catastrophically wrong at that plant, at that organisation, what would you do? What's your fallback? Because inherently they might be a low risk operation in terms of what they're doing and their quality standard, but if you've got no alternative, then they are a high risk to your business. You need to make sure that they are ticking over beautifully, thanks very much. Or find another vendor, find a second source. But it's an important factor to think about in your kind of risk-based approach. The regulatory risks include things like, so the previous audit history with your company, have you audited them frequently in the past? What were the performance levels like in those audits? Also, what were their, what is their inspection history? Do they have regular audits by notified bodies, by the MHRA, FDA, BSI? Do they have a history of that, and is that good? Versus, again, if they don't have a history, doesn't necessarily mean that's a bad thing, but it's an unknown. And I think in factoring in risks, if you don't have the data, you naturally have to assume that that's a high risk until you know otherwise. Then we've got kind of more intangible factors. So things like so reputation. So again, it's about that feeling. It's putting some kind of quantitative measure on that feeling of so what are they like to work with? Are they responsive? Do they come forward with information? Do they communicate with us between audits, or do they just put on a show when we go and audit and then they're a nightmare to get in touch with in between times? Do they send us the things that we ask them to? Do we have a good rapport, a good dialogue with them? Do they have a good reputation themselves in the industry? What's the risk? And I put here again visibility of the product. So if they are one of your key suppliers, if the product they supply to you is your, you know, it's your flagship product or it's your flagship service, again, to ensure that your organisation aren't caught out, you might want to visit them more frequently just to protect your own business. Their quality standards, their performance might be excellent, but what is the risk of that, something going wrong with that product to your business? And then there are financial risks to bring into play as well. So again, I've put it on twice because I think it's really important. Are they your only vendor, and are they a single source? Because if they are your only source of that product, then you need to be truly assured that they are performing brilliantly. Because if they go down, again, could be and have an enormous impact financially on your company. And also, again, the cost of the product. I work for a number of organisations in the pharma industry who are dealing with really early stage clinical materials. They only have the tiniest amount, and it costs them an absolute fortune to make that. So they don't want to give that to any Tom, Dick or Harry. They want to know that that product is being looked after and is safe and is in good quality hands. They can't afford for that product to go missing or be damaged. So those kind of factors certainly do come into play. Okay, and so a bit then about kind of supplier audit approach. I know that I'm speaking to the converted here, so I'm sure lots of you are performing audits in exactly this way, but just to give you kind of an insight into my approach. So supplier auditing, the amount of preparation that you put in up front, I believe, will be directly related to the success of that audit. So do your research, know practically where you're going, how you're going to get there. I was working with somebody once who rocked up to an organisation in entirely the wrong part of the country. Woke up the next day, asked for a taxi, and they said, oh, that's about 500 miles away. So know where you're going, know who you're meeting, know what that organisation does for you. So an audit is not an audit is not an audit. Everyone needs to be different. So understand what you're going to see, understand why you're going there. Understand what your focus needs to be. Again, is it a vendor selection audit? Is it routine and repetitive? Has something gone wrong? Gather that data beforehand so you know whether they've had problems with non-conformances or recalls or issues with product supply. And you can go in and speak to them about that, but also verify the information that they are routinely sending to you as well. It's another way of checking that. And I mean, as auditors, we'd all love to spend forever on these sites. If they invite us there for a week, that would be brilliant. We never get that luxury. We've only ever got a small amount of time. So we need to be focused. We need to be targeted. So let's understand what that vendor is doing for us, what the risks are inherent to that operation, that process. And let's focus our agenda on those high risk areas as well. So not only have we taken a risk based approach to which vendors we audit, I believe we should be taking a risk based approach to how we audit that vendor as well. So yes, we want to have a look at the quality system, we want to have a look at the operations, we want to look at training, we want to look at non-conformances. We cannot look at everything. It's only ever a sampling exercise. So if you are auditing a vendor that's manufacturing sterile products for you, then the controls around the sterility and cleanliness and the way they control that and labelling of that non-sterile versus sterile, hugely, hugely important. I'm much rather going to want to look at that than I am to check a sample of 7 training files. Do you know what I mean? I think we've got to be practical and pragmatic, which links me into this part about collection, careful in terms of the selection of auditors. And I know we've talked earlier about kind of auditor competence and evidencing that. But again, it's also about selecting the right auditor for the job. Clearly, if it's an audit of a sterile manufacturer, you need somebody who knows something about that. You need to think about the organisation you're auditing and their style, and make sure you marry that up with somebody who's going to be able to go out there and perform an effective audit in terms of developing that relationship. You also need to think about as well the different styles of auditors. So I've worked with some auditors in the past, a great number of auditors, who were brilliant systems auditors in terms of looking at the paperwork, comparing it to the standard, wonderful. Were like a rabbit in the headlights when you took them out into a manufacturing plant, didn't really know what to do, couldn't follow their nose, wouldn't know a non-conformance on a manufacturing site if it smacked them in the face, but could find a missing document in a training file like nobody's business. So it's about selecting the right person for the job. And obviously knowing your standards, so what are you going to audit against? I have been in embarrassing situations in the past on the audit hosting side of the fence where people do turn up, they don't really know why they're there, they're not really sure what standard is they're auditing against. They're auditing their own preferences rather than to any other legislative requirements. They turn up late, they nip out for phone calls, all of that. We don't want to be those people. It's not professional, but it's also not productive. So we need to go and be prepared in all of those areas. I think the more research and preparation you can do up front, the more able you are going to be able to follow your nose when you're in that audit situation. And then during the audit, like we say, it is about building rapport. I've put here, it's fact-finding with kindness. So we want to go into an audit and find out about the organisation. We absolutely, hopefully, want to find evidence of good practices, but we do want to identify areas of non-conformance if they are there. But as we talked about earlier, it's the way that that is put across, and it's the way that you communicate that. So my recommendation absolutely is operate an audit in an open and collaborative manner. Speak about things when you find them, because again, you might need to discuss that with the auditee to make sure you are truly on the right track. Think about your desired state versus what you're actually finding. How far away is it from that? And think about the risk. Think about the risk. So you might find a non-conformance, but again, it's in the grand scheme of things, how risky is that or not? And ultimately, it's a great opportunity in a supplier audit to figure out whether you actually want to work with them. I've conducted numerous audits in the past where, as part of vendor selections, where you are auditing kind of, you know, 2 suppliers, they both put their bids in, you're going out there. It really, really is important how they host that audit and what kind of feeling you get from them in terms of whether you think you could work with that supplier or not. And then obviously, during the site audit, it is about using your eyes and ears, getting a general impression of what they're doing, say the production, their communications, what equipment they have, how they maintain it, the quality management system, obviously. Thinking about laboratory testing, quality control, training, how reliable are they in terms of doing what they do? I could go on forever about this. I'm very conscious about time, so I will skip over that. But there are lots of things that you need to look at on site, and it is about following a risk-based approach to focus on those areas that you think are going to present the biggest risks to your product. This is... maybe I'll take these questions over stories. I've got absolutely endless scenarios of audits that were horrific. And this is where I was going to tell you all of those stories. I think that they don't always go to plan, no matter how much preparation you put in. But how you as an auditor deal with that, and how you then feed that back to your organisation in terms of what kind of vendor that vendor is, I think is really important. I was doing an audit at the end of last year in Turkey. It was a four-course audit because there had been some problems with the supply of a product. So I was expecting it to be a little bit challenging anyway. But got there, arrived day one, built the rapport, everybody was fine, every man and his dog in the room, the managing director's there, lovely, did the plant tour, everything was fine, a couple of little things, nothing too bad. But they, you could see that they were wanting to try and please me because they wanted to remedy this issue. About 4 o'clock on day one, I was looking at some data around, it was around the validation of the process actually. And as an auditor, have you ever had that moment where you're going, hang on a minute, this looks completely and utterly wrong, but it can't be. I must have forgotten something. I'm going to get my standard back out and just double check that. No, it is. It's completely and utterly not what I was expecting. So I asked the question in a very diplomatic, fact-finding with kindness kind of way, going, I know you're missing something here, but could you explain this to me? You do the, well, what I was expecting to see was this. Could you find that for me? You know, helping, wanting to help them. Shut down, audit room emptied. I was left on my own for about 45 minutes. They came back in and started speaking in Turkish, not in English. They'd done it English for the rest of the time. They were clearing the audit room of papers. I was just like, oh my goodness. Like, right, okay, do you know what? Maybe I can see you're under pressure here. Why don't we wrap the audit up early today? If you could just get X, Y, and Z for me for tomorrow morning. Tomorrow morning arrived, and I'm not kidding, it got to one point where I went, I nipped out to the loo and called the office just for, to hear a kind voice, because I was, it, to say it went from 100 miles an hour going brilliantly to flat stop overnight was tremendous. And the attitude just changed in the room, and I was doing my very best to coach, to mentor, to advise, and the audit from that point was just awful. And we wrapped it up, it was reported as a finding, but I'm going, I've got to report it as a finding because I can't see any data, but do you know, if you've got anything you can send me, I'm willing to see it, I want to do the best to find, to try and remedy this situation. I'm still haggling with them over capital responses and what they can send, and again, it just goes to show you that building that rapport is really important, but the nature and culture of an organisation, when you go and audit them, I would have never found that out had I not gone and done that vendor audit. They are, and the thankfully the client that I'm working with does have an alternative supplier. But that's what that audit is going to lead to, because there was an issue, they didn't deal with it proactively, they shut down in the audit, they're not supportive of kind of coming to a conclusion together. And that's one of the things that the audit programme kind of fleshes out. So. Millions of stories like that. I'm sure we've all got equally hilarious stories to share. So we talk about just to close out, managing the follow-up activities. So we're all familiar with this process. So close out meeting, we share the report, we invite them to respond to CAPAs, we review the CAPAs, hopefully they're appropriate, and we can carry on working with that vendor. We might want to see some evidence of those CAPAs depending on our systems or how serious those things are. But again, for me, in terms of building a rapport with a supplier, the timeliness of their responses and how they respond to those CAPAs, those findings, tells you an awful lot about the culture of the organisation, and that answering the whether you want to work with them question or not. And you're then into, I put here rinse and repeat, because it used to be rinse and repeat. It used to be, right, we've done that, we'll do it again, say, see you same time next year, Joe. Or same time in 2 years, or same time in 5 years. We need to now take the outputs of those audits and factor them into our risk-based approach and consider whether we do need to do the same thing next time or not. Do we need to go back more frequently? Can we take a step back? So are they actually brilliant? Do we go less frequently? Do we send them a questionnaire next time? Do we do an interview over the phone? But rinse and repeat in exactly the same form is not the way we need to do that. Now, it's not the best use of our resources, and it's certainly not the best way of identifying and working with the risks. One thing that I just wanted to kind of put in here at the end was, I've seen this frequently recently, which is why I've mentioned it. In your agreements with suppliers, they should allow you to audit. You should have a clause in your agreements with your suppliers that gives you the right to audit. It might be at a defined frequency, it might be not more than, you know, certainly not more than once a month or once a year or whatever. It might be some kind of constraints on that, but suppliers should be happy for you to audit them. If they are not, that tells you an awful lot about their organisation. But one way that you can communicate clearly with suppliers that you are going to come and audit them and you are going to insist upon that is about having that clause in your agreements with them. So some quick conclusions. So we're preaching to the converted. We all know that rigorous, thorough audits are a great quality and compliance tool. They absolutely are. They help us to assure quality throughout our supply chains. But taking a risk-based approach to that auditing programme really helps us to focus our energy, our activity, and hopefully improve quality and compliance across the board, both in our own organisations and the organisations that we are auditing. And it really does, it should be encouraging. Vendors should be happy to be auditors. They should want us to be there. They should want to learn from those inputs. And that tells us a lot about those organisations. So they should be prepared for people to come in and audit them. It should just be another learning opportunity, another opportunity to engage with their customers and to demonstrate how good they are and how proud they are of the systems that they operate to. But it's about then taking those learnings back into our organisations and applying that practically and pragmatically so that we are focusing our energies in those areas of high risk. Bang on time! Anybody got any questions?
Yeah, I've got one. In my experience, on quite a few occasions, the biggest risk is downstream. It's the incompetence of your customer. How do you factor that in?
Very good point. Yeah, no, it can be. So I think, and that comes then down into what the way you manage and triage customer complaints. Are all customer complaints equal? Probably not. Do you have a way of triaging valid complaints and invalid complaints? But I think also it's that then as an organisation comes into is there something around learning and educating the customers, the end users of the products? Do you need to think about your packaging or the illustrations or the literature that you send with that? Do you have a video online which is a dummy's guide to, and this is how you use this product? But you're right, I think sometimes we can be confused and think we've got a problem with one of our products when actually we haven't. It's the way the customers use it or aren't using it appropriately that's right. Yeah, absolutely. But factoring that again into your metrics and understanding which are valid or not valid, which are product quality related complaints and kind of non-product quality related complaints can help you separate them out a little bit.
It's an important point.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Absolutely. Yes, yeah. Yes.
We've had to, I suppose, audit more again for the purpose of partnering.
Yes.
And for anything else.
Yeah.
Because certainly from the water industry, we had certain supply ranges that were 12 companies in the UK.
Yeah.
12, 20 years ago.
Yeah, fab. Now there's like one. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
And always one, and there's one in France.
Yeah.
And we've got the whole water industry in the UK.
Yeah.
Now both.
Exactly. I couldn't agree more. I think, and I've been in situations like that working with companies who wanted to enter new markets and there's only been one person that they've been able to work with. I have one example again, it was in Turkey again, that's purely coincidental, where I'd gone out to do an audit and they'd already been chosen and they were dreadful. But the organisation had no option but to go with that vendor. So then it is about making it a collaboration, and you do have to become partners, and as an organisation you do have to kind of say, right, well, if we want to be here in this territory, in this particular space, we are going to have to invest some of our time and energy in working with this vendor to get them working aligned with our principles, And recognising your organisation that you're going to have, it's not going to be a, we need you to do this, do it. You're probably going to have to help them do that. Or there's the other scenario. I've been in, worked in kind of herbal and natural medicines where there might only be one vendor worldwide for a particular piece of equipment or a particular supply. And they aren't great, but it's a choice between having that product out there on the market, which is of a benefit to patients, or not at all. So your risk ranking and your risk rating kind of is modified accordingly, because there are risks that you perhaps will tolerate or will kind of accept, because it's the benefit risk profile of being able to work in that area or not work in that area. But I think it just means you need to have your eyes and ears completely wide open, and the closer you can work in partnership with those sole vendors, the better, because it is a big risk to your organisation. Sometimes you do get in a bit of a kind of a combative situation where they're just doing what they're doing and they actually don't really care what you want, they're just going to do what they want anyway. And I think that is then about, as auditors or as quality professionals, making sure that we do log those risks, we acknowledge them, and it's, that's another thing. As our as auditors, it's not our job to accept those risks, it's our job to record them, interpret them, and present them to the organisation, and ultimately it's the organisation that chooses whether to accept those risks or not. But it's not an ideal situation to be in, I appreciate that, absolutely, so thank you for your feedback. Hi, yes?
Yeah, ethical sourcing is a major issue. I mean, some of our customers want us to produce a modern slavery policy for them, but I mean, when you're dealing with people overseas, not even here, you've got the questions of child labour, slave labour, or just generally, are you trading fairly?
Yes,
Are you trying to cut them down to the bone so that they'll be back next year?
Absolutely. And I think, again, as an organisation, your company sets the culture and the standards of what you expect to see. And again, hopefully you would expect to see that in your suppliers. So as well as auditing to the standard, which is the standard in your industry, it's about saying, so do you expect to see those kind of policies and procedures in place? Are they important to your organisation? And if so, factoring that into your supplier approval programme. But again, it's about applying potentially a level of pragmatism or factoring that into your risk-based approach, because if somebody is absolutely brilliant in 99 out of 100 of the criteria, but they don't have a policy on X, will that stop you working with them? Again, that's up to you to decide, isn't it? Yeah, absolutely. But becoming a lot more common across every industry to factor in those kind of ethical factors, for sure.